To the 18th meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, with apologies from Karen Adam, and Emma Roddick is attending as Karen's substitute. So as usual, can I ask Emma Roddick to declare any relevant interests?
No relevant interests, thank you.
Thank you. Before we start this morning, I want to make a short statement on some relevant developments in order to update members and those who follow our work. Today, we'll hear from two expert panels as part of our Stage 1 evidence on the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill. The committee had hoped to hear evidence from Professor Alice Sullivan as part of today's first panel, and although Professor Sullivan was not able to join us today, I'm pleased that she has accepted our invitation and should be with us on Tuesday, the 21st of June. We had also hoped to hear from Dr. Hilary Cass as part of today's second panel. Dr. Cass has declined the committee's invitation, indicating that she's published her interim report and referring us to that and other published statements she has made. Committee's also invited a number of respected associations representing medical professionals, but several have declined the committee's invitation to attend in person today, and some have agreed to give written evidence, which the committee will be able to consider as part of our Stage 1 inquiry. Last week, the committee heard from witnesses representing faith groups and secular society. As committee members are aware, ahead of that session, the committee had approached a range of faith groups, but for a variety of reasons, they declined our invitation to attend last week. And I hope that provides clarity for those following the committee's work. Going forward, as agreed by the committee, clerks are working with a variety of parents' groups to organise an informal evidence session in order that we can hear from parents whose children have a transgender identity. Clerks are also looking to arrange for the committee to hear informally from people who have transitioned and then have chosen to reverse the process. So clerks will publish further details on these sessions in due course. I hope all of that information helps to clarify some of the queries around the committee's agreed approach towards oral evidence sessions. So we'll now move on to our first agenda item, which is to continue to take evidence on the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill. And I welcome our first panel to this morning's evidence session. And so I welcome Professor Sharon Cowan, Professor of Feminist and Queer Legal Studies at the University of Edinburgh School of Law. Naomi Cunningham, Barrister, Outer Temple Chambers and Chair of Sex Matters. And Karen Monaghan, QC, Barrister, Matrix Chambers. I refer members to Papers 1 and 2. And I'd now like to invite each of our witnesses to make short opening statements, starting with Professor Cowan, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the committee for inviting me to give evidence to you today. I'm the Professor of Feminist and Queer Legal Studies in the School of Law at the University of Edinburgh. My research focuses on three main areas of study: criminal law, particularly the area of sexual offences and violence against women, asylum and refugee law and policy, and LGBTQ rights, particularly those of trans people. And I've been working on these issues for over 25 years. Most recently, I've worked on a project that asks trans people about their understanding and experiences of equality law in Scotland, Canada, and the US. I've also worked alongside Scottish Trans in Scotland, and I'm on the advisory board of the Scottish Just Law Centre, whom I think you've heard from in a previous session. Focusing particularly on the Scottish context, when I interviewed trans people in 2016 and 17, it was striking to me how many of them said that they were proud to live in Scotland because it was leading the way on many issues concerning LGBTQ communities, including equality laws and hate crime laws, and that Scotland was, and I quote from one of my participants, the best place on the planet to be trans. However, as the committee has heard from many others already, it's been recognised that the current system of gender recognition introduced in 2004 is in many ways no longer fit for purpose, not least because of its outdated reliance on the diagnosis of gender dysphoria. Replacing the current process with one that reflects international human rights standards and standards of good practice, as outlined by the Scottish Human Rights Commission in their submission, is now an urgent matter, as Scotland lags behind other jurisdictions in affording legal rights of recognition to its transgender and, I might add, non-binary residents. If the Scottish Government chooses to introduce a system of self-declaration of gender, they will not be setting an international precedent. On the contrary, they'll be following the lead of countries such as Argentina, Denmark, Malta, Norway, Ireland, Belgium, Colombia, Brazil, Portugal, Luxembourg and Pakistan, countries that have introduced such a system without any reported problems. And they'll also be complying with the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe's call in 2015 to develop quick, transparent and accessible procedures based on self-determination. Rather than be an outlier, Scotland is at risk, as it was with the Gender Recognition Act in 2004, of being one of the last to reform its law in this area. And I look forward to answering the committee's questions and helping Parliament to create a bill that reflects the dynamic and progressive community that we know Scotland is and can continue to be. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I go to Naomi Cunningham, please?
Thank you. It's a peculiarity of this debate that some, at least on both sides, maintain that the grant of GRCs, gender recognition certificates, doesn't affect the operation of the Equality Act. And in particular, the single-sex exceptions in the Gender in the Equality Act. My position is that, as a matter of law, it shouldn't. Whether or not someone has a gender recognition certificate should make no difference to the operation of the single-sex exceptions in the Equality Act. But we can't be sure of that. Anyway, in practice, it makes them more difficult to use. It's more difficult for organisations that seek to maintain single-sex services or spaces in practice to deal with individuals with gender recognition certificates. Where you are on this question depends in part on what you think the concept of sex means in the Equality Act. Some say that sex already means self-identified sex. If they're right, getting a gender recognition certificate doesn't change your sex for the purposes of the Equality Act, because your sex for the purposes of the Equality Act is already whatever you say it is. I think that position is legally untenable. Some say sex in the Equality Act means legal sex, that is biological sex, except when modified by a gender recognition certificate. If those people are right, a gender recognition certificate undoubtedly does change the legal analysis of the way that the single-sex exceptions operate. But in my view, it's difficult to imagine real circumstances in which it would change the outcome of that analysis. So it changes the route, but in my view, it almost never, never or almost never will change the destination. And the reason for that is that the single-sex exceptions in the Equality Act are justified or not justified as a matter of practical impact, not as a matter of certification. I want to make that concrete because I think it's important to think about the consequences of proposed legislation in very concrete terms. So if I, as a woman, look up while drying myself in the women's open plan changing room at the swimming pool and meet the eye of a naked male person, my feelings are going to be some mixture of surprise, embarrassment, anger and fear. Whether or not that male person has a secret certificate in a drawer at home isn't going to make any difference at all to that mix of feelings in me. Most of the exceptions are variations on that theme. They're conditioned by a recognition of the needs and feelings of the general user of single-sex spaces. It's bodies, not identities and not certificates, that affect those needs and feelings. My own view, picking from those three possible interpretations of what sex means in the Equality Act, is that sex in the Equality Act simply means biological sex. The consequence of that is that nothing about the way the sex discrimination provisions work is affected by whether someone has a gender recognition certificate or not. For these purposes, they remain of their biological sex. But we have yet to learn which of these three views is right. And these are tangled and difficult questions on which reasonable people, even reasonable lawyers, can disagree. I believe that Karen and I disagree on this specific point to start with. And I'm sure Karen and I and Sharon probably have three different views on these questions. I've recently changed my mind on what legal sex in the Equality Act means. I was in the legal sex camp, that is, biological sex as modified by our gender recognition certificate, until a few days ago. But I've thought deeply about it, and rereading the Equality Act, and particularly the single-sex exception provisions, with a view to their practical consequences, has persuaded me that sex must mean biological sex. There are even more vexed questions arising out of the bill about cross-border effects of Scottish gender recognition certificates. Questions like, what is the legal status of a Scottish-born 16 or 17-year-old with a Scottish GRC who attends a school in England, and how is the school supposed to manage those legal and practical problems? But finally, I want to point out that the law isn't just about what courts ultimately decide that it means. It's also about what people think it means. And often that's the most important thing in practice. You can have a folk understanding, if you like, of the law that operates in practice for years before anyone actually brings a test case about it and finds out that that's wrong. And that's what affects what happens on the ground. If you enact amendments to the Gender Recognition Act that change both the size and the profile of the group who can be granted gender recognition certificates, what you will do in practice is create a class of people of unknown size and unknown characteristics who have an expectation that because the law recognises them as the opposite sex, they're entitled to be treated as the opposite sex by everyone around them in all circumstances. When they learn that that's not the case, that that's a wholly unrealistic expectation, it's not going to happen, they're going to be disappointed and angry. So this change, proposed, I'm sure, with the very best of intentions, is capable of having consequences for the very people it's intended to help that are, in fact, positively cruel. Thank you.
Thank you. And Karen Monaghan, please.
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me. Just to say something about myself, I'm a barrister practising in the sphere of equality law, and have been for just over 30 years. And I'd like to say something about the scheme of the Equality Act and say something about the impact in the changes anticipated by the bill so far as the Act is concerned. Firstly, as to the meaning of the two key definitions or the two key concepts under the Act, sex and gender reassignment. As to sex, sex under the Act means biological sex, and we know that for two reasons, in fact three reasons. Firstly, sex is defined as being a man or a woman. Secondly, male, man and woman is defined as being male or female, as the case may be. Male and female, as a matter of dictionary definition, correspond to biological sex. And thirdly, case law indicates that sex under the Equality Act means biological sex. Biological sex will ordinarily correspond to legal sex. The importance of that I'll come to in one moment. So biological sex, which ordinarily corresponds to legal sex, that's what sex means under the Act. Concept of gender reassignment, that is a characteristic of transsexual people, and I use transsexual people only once because that's the language of the Act. I'll use trans hereafter. But gender reassignment is a characteristic of trans people. It's given a very wide meaning indeed, for good reasons. So it means a person who is proposing to undergo, is undergoing, or has undergone a process of reassigning their sex. So one need not even have started the process of transitioning to be protected by the provisions addressing gender reassignment. That's a very positive thing because it means a person who goes into work and says to their employer, I'm proposing to undergo gender reassignment, can't be dismissed, or at least if they are, they'll have a claim of discrimination. What it doesn't do is change a person's legal sex. As to the single-sex services, which is one of the key areas of controversy, that is a positive action measure. It ensures that women, and I'll use women here because that seems to be the area of controversy, or females. Females can access spaces that they may otherwise be excluded from for reasons of privacy, trauma, and so on. Single-sex services are those services targeted at only one legal sex. A women's single-sex service will be targeted at and open to only those who are legally female. That means a trans woman without a GRC that attends a women-only single-sex service can be excluded because they are legally male. Not so if they have a GRC, I'll come to. If they're legally male, there are exceptions to that where it would be indirect discrimination to do so, that it would be a rule that disadvantages trans people. But given the wide meaning given to the concept of gender reassignment, that is by no means inevitable. So if a trans woman without a GRC seeks to access a female-only service, the starting point is they can be excluded because they are legally male. Where a person has a gender recognition certificate, then as this committee knows, they are to be treated for all relevant purposes as of the legal sex recorded on their gender recognition certificate. If a trans woman with a GRC seeks to access a women-only service, they cannot be excluded because they are legally female, unless their exclusion or a policy excluding trans women can be justified. That requires a legitimate aim to be shown and that it be proportionate. So if you don't have a GRC, you can be lawfully excluded. That's the starting point. If you do have a GRC, you can't be unless it's justified. When Parliament enacted the Equality Act in 2010, it would have had very much in mind that there were few trans women with gender recognition certificates, talking about a cohort of about 300 a year, and that there would have been an objective assessment by an independent panel as to an entitlement to a GRC. So what this panel proposes, forgive me, what is proposed in the bill, I beg your pardon, excuse me, what's proposed in the bill is that the cohort of people who are entitled to a gender recognition certificate and therefore can access women-only spaces, save where justified, is very much larger and very much larger than we can assume Parliament intended when it enacted the Equality Act. Those are my opening observations, safe to say that the Convention, the European Convention, does not require a scheme of this sort. And whether or not this bill is enacted, the Equality Act model doesn't need to be changed. It's just that this committee needs to be mindful of the impact of making the scheme more liberal. I hope those observations are of assistance.
Thank you very much for that. That's all useful, all three contributions. We'll now move to questions, starting with Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning, and thank you for your opening statements and other information that some of you have provided. I want to explore two areas. Firstly, the case for change or the need for gender recognition reform at all, and then questions around gender dysphoria diagnosis and the panel that has been associated with that process. Sharon, if I could come to you first. In your opening remarks, you talked about the shift in views that you've identified amongst the trans people you speak to in the last 5 years about Scotland being a great place to live to not being the case. And I'm wondering how you see that as being linked to or otherwise, not so much the discussions around this bill, and we know that they've already been to consultations, but on the need for change, on the need for something that is within the current GRA to be different.
Yes, thank you. So it's notable that the people that I spoke to in my research We had conversations before this recent, kind of more recent in the last 5 years, move towards change. So their reflections on how it was to live in Scotland under the at that point in time, the current equality regime and all of the other elements of law that affected trans people was more positive. I think partly for the reasons that you mentioned about the way that this conversation has evolved, but also because I think there is now an acceptance that the need for a diagnosis of gender dysphoria is problematic. And I know that the committee has heard from many people on that particular issue, both from a health perspective, in terms of accessing even a diagnosis, which can take years and delay the whole process of gender recognition, but also in terms of the way that people access healthcare according to their other individual needs that intersect with their gender identity, with disability, race, religion, living in a rural part of Scotland rather than an urban part of Scotland, and so on. So that I think that's primarily the move that has been seen across the international terrain, if you like, through WHO and WPATH and all of those international organisations that have made that move. And I would say that's from my perspective and from working alongside Scottish Trans, that is the number one thing that trans people would say is difficult for them about the current gender recognition process. There are other aspects too, but that's primarily the problem that they face.
Thanks, Sharon, that's helpful. And that, I mean, you said in your opening statement that the need for gender dysphoria diagnosis is viewed internationally as outdated now. I suppose that links quite closely with the current process of having the panel of medical experts that assesses information. Can you just give some comments from the trans people you've spoken to and from your analysis of that process as appropriate or otherwise?
Well, again, having worked with people in the community, but also with organisations who deal directly on the front line with trans people, that question is so the work of the gender recognition panel is not like another tribunal, which when you can go in and actually sit and watch what the proceedings are, which you can do with lots of other courtrooms and tribunals. So the work of the gender recognition panel is, I wouldn't say it was secret, that sounds a bit insidious, but it's private for lots of good reasons. But that means it's difficult to assess how the decisions are being made. So the information on which we assess how the decisions are being made are usually about the correspondence between the tribunal and the people who are applying for a gender recognition certificate. And again, from my understanding, that correspondence is not always very helpful in terms of asking for more and more information and repeated attempts to gain intrusive bits of information about what kinds of medical interventions they've had and so on, and that process puts off potentially a large group of people from even applying for a gender recognition certificate in the first place.
Thanks very much. That's helpful. Naomi, can I come to you and ask a similar question around your views on the case for change, if you view there is one? I know in your opening comments you talked about that larger group of people being potentially eligible. What is your view on whether or not reform is necessary?
Yes, it seems to me that the two biggest, most important changes that are proposed in the bill are the reduction in the age limit to 16, the reduction in the minimum age to 16, and self-identification, the removal of medical gatekeeping. So taking the second of those first, I don't think the case is made out for the change proposed. I think the removal of any sort of medical gatekeeping, the removal of a requirement for a diagnosis of gender dysphoria, opens the process up and the availability of a gender recognition certificate up to a group of unknown size and unknown characteristics. We simply don't know who will apply for gender recognition certificates if all they have to do is declare that they intend to live permanently in their desired sex. We don't know what the characteristics of that group will be. The Gender Recognition Act was originally passed to meet the needs of what was at the time perceived and repeatedly stated to be a tiny minority of individuals with the distressing condition of gender dysphoria. So severe, it was assumed that they felt the need to take medical steps to modify their bodies to look as much as possible like the sex they wish they were. And self-ID blows that wide open into a group of wholly unknown nature, but potentially including those who choose to cross-dress for erotic purposes. And there's nothing in the proposed legislation that would prevent erotic cross-dressers from simply applying for a gender recognition certificate in order to make it easier for them to access single-sex spaces. Now, they may not mean any more harm than finding their satisfaction from being seen in public as women and treated in all respects as women. But nevertheless, women are entitled to male-free spaces when they're naked, when they're vulnerable, when they're asleep, when they're undressing. And they're particularly entitled, I would suggest, it ought to be particularly obvious, that they're entitled to have privacy from males whose desire to be seen as the opposite sex is for erotic purposes. So I'm particularly troubled by that.
Okay, can I just come back on a couple of things? I think, firstly, in a lot of what we've heard, the assumption is always that it's trans women we're talking about. I think we must recognise that trans men exist too. And Sharon mentioned non-binary people in her opening remarks. But I'm interested in when you say that question of gender dysphoria and the medicalization, given that the World Health Organization has reclassified it, and given that we know there is increasing evidence that not all trans people experience gender dysphoria, how then can we retain a restriction that excludes trans people from getting a GRC?
Well, I want to put that question back to you, if I may. You say not all trans people experience gender dysphoria, but if that's the case, I'm not sure I understand what you mean by a trans person.
So I think the evidence is increasingly clear. There is substantial published research from engagement directly with trans people that is not always the case. And in the same way as I wouldn't want to prescribe what being a woman has to be, you have to look a certain way, you have to dress a certain way, you have to act a certain way. That's sexism. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that to trans people either.
But if you define a trans person simply as anybody who defines themselves as a trans person, you have a hopelessly circular definition. And you can't make any useful generalisations about the characteristics of that group. I would say if you're going to... The consequences of a gender recognition certificate are quite extreme. They make very substantial demands on the rest of society. They threaten those who know about the existence of the gender recognition certificate and the previous gender identity with criminal penalties for disclosure, those who know about it in an official capacity, with criminal penalties for disclosure of that information. They at least open up questions about access to single-sex spaces and services. They make quite a lot of demands on other people. It doesn't seem to me to be unreasonable to say that this is a serious and elaborate accommodation which may need to be made for some small number of people if they prove their need for it. But it shouldn't just be given out to anyone who says, I'd like it, please.
But I suppose what one of the questions, particularly around the panel and that process of submitting evidence, you know, and requiring more evidence proving that you are who you say you are, that's intrusive, and surely trans people deserve privacy as well.
Well, the whole a lot of the point of the Gender Recognition Act is to give transsexuals, as defined, privacy, provided they meet the qualifying conditions. But it is privacy with quite serious consequences. It, for example, creates an opportunity for what we Sex Matters in our submission have referred to as identity laundering. It makes that quite easy. So simply to say that anyone who asks for it without any sort of proof that they have the real need of it, that the original Gender Recognition Act was passed to provide for, seems to me to be radically rewiring the nature of the task that the Gender Recognition Act does. It was passed in response to Goodwin in the European Court of Human Rights, and the recognition in that, that there were people who had taken every possible step that medical science could provide them with to transition. And they were in a difficult position because they looked in, they might well pass, some of them might pass anyway. But anyway, they'd taken difficult and painful and frightening steps to change their identity, and the state should recognise that and should accommodate that by allowing them to marry and so on. So that original purpose is very clear. And what this change to self-ID threatens to do is blow that wide open to something completely different and make the Act do something completely different. But before I want to finish on your question, before I finish on your question, I do want to talk about age as well, because that's the other very worrying respect.
I know somebody else wants to come in on age later on, so I'll leave them to do that if that's okay.
Well, you asked the question, so I'd like to finish my answer to it. The other particular difficulty with the proposed changes is the change down, the reduction in the age limit to 16. And what I think you need to have very clearly in mind on that is what Hilary Cass has said about the serious intervention that social transition is. And legal transition must be a step. It's a step even further than social transition. If you crystallise a child's legal identity as the opposite sex at the age of 16 or 17, how difficult will it be for that child as they mature? And human brains, I believe, don't mature fully till about 25. How difficult will it be for that child to say, actually, I got it wrong?
I know that there are my colleagues around the table who will come back on certain points that you've made in that. Karen, can I come to you? I know what you said in your opening comments and opening remarks. I'm interested in your question or your thoughts on that medicalisation process, whether you agree that medicalisation of gender dysphoria in that way is problematic, and whether or not you see that shift or that shift away from requiring that diagnosis being necessary.
I'm sort of somewhere between Sharon and Naomi. I recognise that the diagnosis gender dysphoria is increasingly one that both internationally and indeed domestically is challenged or perhaps not recognised. So I understand that. I do have a concern, however, for the reasons I've given about the size of the group who might qualify for a gender recognition certificate if this bill's enacted. I do have a concern about the absence of any meaningful gatekeeping, to use the word of Naomi, the description of Naomi. There's very little by way of checking whether or not a person meets a requirement or requirements that will satisfy a gender recognition certificate. You made the observation that we need to move away from the idea of gender stereotyping. If we don't have a medical diagnosis, and I completely see the reasons why that's problematic, but if we don't have a medical diagnosis, what do we mean by living in the opposite gender? What does that mean? How does one tell whether somebody's living in the opposite gender? So it concerns me about the absence of any objective assessment, any gatekeeping. And it also concerns me for reasons of legal certainty. How do we know whether a person is meaningfully trans without any objective assessment? So while I completely understand what Sharon says, and I don't in any sense suggest that she's wrong, and I completely accept that concern about a diagnosis of gender dysphoria. It does worry me that there doesn't appear to be any objective threshold for determining whether or not a person ought to be entitled to a gender recognition certificate.
Thanks. And I note the evidence that you gave in Westminster in February last year, and you said very, very similar things. And when you talk about gatekeeping and safeguards, what kinds of things do you have in mind?
That's the difficulty. At the moment, we have gender dysphoria. So everybody knows an assessment can be made. It may be controversial, but there's a panel. There's no means here of testing either permanence, besides self-declaration. There could be a panel that makes some objective assessment, determines whether or not this is real permanence, determines whether or not there's a meaningful dysphoria, even if it can't be characterised as a medical condition, but some gatekeeping. And as I say, it's problematic as well for legal certainty. The model of the Equality Act, you don't need justification, or the starting point, forgive me, you may need in certain circumstances, but the model, the starting point is you don't need to justify the exclusion of a woman, I'll use woman, because that seems to be the area of controversy. You don't need to justify the exclusion of a trans woman without a GRC from a women-only service because they're legally male. But you do if they're legally female. How does one determine whether or not a person is meaningfully legally female, where all you have is self-declaration? What does that mean? How does one live as a woman and without any gatekeeping, any objective assessment of permanence and some form of dysphoria? How does one slot that in? It's not the model, as I say, it's the slotting in of a gender recognition certificate without an objective assessment.
Okay, thank you. I suppose there are no other identities that we may have as human beings that require gatekeeping in that way, and I struggle in terms of those currently recognised by the Equality Act.
Not so. Nationality, citizenship, and there may be a requirement to show heritage if you have a service that's targeted at Irish travellers because of particular health difficulties in the traveller community. And they might have to show some evidence to show...
And there are protections accordingly for that. But I suppose the question around, the wider group and what characteristics might be included in that wider group, I think there are questions for me around why that is of the legal significance that two of you on the panel seem to be given. But I appreciate we probably need to move on. So I'll leave it there for now. Thanks, Joe.
Thank you. You're reading my mind. Thanks very much. We do need to be cautious for time. There's a good number of areas that members are wanting to cover, but we did cover more there, I think, than we'd expected to. So that's good. Thanks for that. Fulton McGregor, please.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thanks for your opening statements and responses so far. I'd like to ask questions around two areas that I've been exploring with previous panels, and that's the provision to live in the required gender for 3 months, and then secondly, the three-month reflection period. So if I could start with the former. I guess what I've picked up from all previous panels so far is this actually seems to be an area in quite a controversial bill. This seems to be an area of broad agreement from what we've picked up so far, although maybe not for exactly the same reasons. But we are hearing, even from those who support the bill, that to live in the acquired gender for 3 months could be seen as quite demeaning, because it's likely that the individual has been living that way for quite some time. And for those perhaps who have got concerns about the bill, I'll use that word rather than opposed to it. There's concerns that the time period isn't long enough, and maybe relates back into some of the concerns that Naomi mentioned earlier about perhaps increasing the number of people more than the Scottish Government currently think. So I'm wondering what your views on that. I'm happy to start with yourself, Sharon. What are your views on this? And obviously, one of the things we've heard as well is from across the board is a concern about the use of the term acquired gender and what that might mean. Sharon, if you've got any views on this, and then I'll just come to Karen and then Naomi.
So unsurprisingly, perhaps, I am also sceptical about the need for a three-month living in the acquired gender requirement for the very reasons that you have stated and that other witnesses to the committee have stated, that that many trans people have been thinking about this, not just for months at a time, but years and in some cases decades. The requirement to live in the acquired gender for 3 months seems unnecessary in terms of delay to the process. I mean, there is a range of ways of approaching this. International jurisdictions have taken different views on whether there should be a time delay in place or not. Some people have very similar requirements to the ones proposed in the bill. Other jurisdictions, such as Malta, is a 30-day registration administrative process that doesn't take very long. Again, my experience with talking to and working with trans people is that they would see that as unnecessary and also delaying in an unhelpful way the process of registration. So that would be my response to that question. Do you want me to address the acquired gender
question? I'll come to that. In terms of the terminology, that's okay. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, I have to say I'm not quite sure what the question is getting at. Is, are you asking, is that a problematic term? Do I think that's a problematic term? Is that what you're asking me?
Yeah, that's what we've been told by previous witnesses, that there's worries about the term.
Yeah, in my view, this is my personal view. I can't speak for anyone else in this. I think it's a very odd phrase. I've always said that since the Act was introduced in 2004. I've written about that, so on record, that I think the use of the word acquired is a very strange thing. Sort of makes it sound like something you've either picked up out of the cupboard, or that you somehow come across it. It's just landed in your lap, or has come out of the back of a lorry or something. You've acquired a secondhand washing machine or something. It's a very odd phrase. I think the difficulty, and I'm sure that actually this is something that we might all agree about in this area, is that the language is really difficult. And so trying to capture what we mean by all of these terms, sex, gender, acquired gender, woman, man, which in human experience is very complicated and dynamic, into a statutory form for the purposes of law, is nigh impossible. We have to do it because we want some standards and rules and norms to live by, but it's a very difficult process. I'm not comfortable with the phrase acquired gender, but we could have a two-hour session on what an alternative phrase might be.
Thank you, Sean. Kat?
I think my greater concern is about the absence of gatekeeping, as I've described. I can see why 3 months after the application, what's the purpose of that? As Sharon said, the likelihood is, not in all cases, but the likelihood is that for some people, they will have spent some time considering whether or not to apply for a gender recognition certificate at all. And why 3 months? Why not 6 months? Why not a year? Why not anything at all? So my main concern is less about the delay, but more about the threshold for qualification at all. That is, living in the gender to which one wants to transition or acquire. I too have problems with the language, perhaps different problems from that identified by Sharon. I think the language adopted by the Equality Act is clear and certain. We know what sex means, and for the avoidance of doubt, it's defined. So there's no ambiguity about that. The difficulty is introducing the concept of gender, which generally refers, as you know, to social attributes, and then descending into the sorts of sex or gender stereotyping that your colleague referred to. How does one live in the gender that one wants to acquire? What does that mean without a medical assessment? And as I say, I'd like to reiterate that I see the concerns about a medical diagnosis, but it does concern me that there's no real tests for determining gender and how one establishes that they're living in the gender to which they wish to assign, and particularly the concern about gatekeeping. So I think the Equality Act gets it right, but I have to say I think the Gender Recognition Act, whether or not this bill is passed, uses language that's difficult and complex. But
thanks, Carl. Naomi, have you got anything on this?
I haven't got very much to add to that, I don't think. I don't personally have any particular problem with the expression acquired gender. I think, as Sharon suggests, you could spend a very long time trying to find a better, more acceptable expression, or more acceptable to all parties expression, without getting any further forward. We are talking about a transition from one legal status, at least, to another. So something that reflects that seems to make sense. And for myself, I don't really understand what it is to live in the acquired gender. It's very hard to imagine what other than conformity to the stereotypes expected of the opposite sex that could mean. So I don't feel strongly about those provisions.
OK, thank you. Moving on to the second area of which is the 3 months reflection period, and I'll do it the opposite way this time, Naomi, because I know that going at the end there, a lot of the points may have been covered, so I'll go the opposite way. And again, we've heard some concerns about 3 month reflection period, and I wonder if you've got views on that. And we've heard concerns probably from, again, about like the last thing, from both sides of the argument, but probably more profoundly this time for different reasons. Naomi, have you got any views on the reflection period?
Again, no strong views, except perhaps in the case of children. If the amendment to reduce the minimum age goes forward, then I think anything that gives children, considering making such a fundamental change to their legal status, a little bit more pause for thought and a little bit more time to mature and consider all the ramifications of that, has to be a good thing. But beyond that, I don't think I have much to say on that.
Good, thanks, Emily. Cam?
Similarly, I don't have any observations to make about that, except no doubt the committee will be wanting to consider the particular position of children. But for adults, I don't have any observations to make about that.
OK, thanks, Cam. Sharon?
I mean, similarly to what I said before, I think it's an arbitrary number of months. We often make big decisions for ourselves that we're not asked to reflect on. Some of them are statutory declarations, like getting married. And I again, from talking with trans people, working alongside trans people, I think the 3 month reflection period is not a very helpful kind of framework. If you were really worried that this was a life changing decision that people might want to reflect on, and you wanted to, you know, stress that for some reason, then 3 months actually seems like a very short period of time. But in the sense that most trans people have thought about this for decades, years, months, long periods of time in advance, the 3 month reflection period just doesn't seem to be particularly helpful, I would say.
Thanks, Sharon. I just comment to Naomi and Karen that the issue about age was something that we heard quite strongly from previous panels as well, but like Maggie had mentioned earlier, I think there's others who are going to explore that area, which is why I didn't have any follow-ups. But thank you all three for your answers here.
Thanks. Okay, thanks very much. And Rachel Hamilton, please.
Thank you. It's just to really develop the questioning around the reducing the age from 18 to 16, and it's just opening the discussion as to whether you believe that people of age 16 are mature enough to make these decisions. I mean, we've heard lots of examples. It's very polarised, as you know, following the committee evidence. But, you know, at 16, you can get married, you can join the army. At 18, you can buy fireworks, have a tattoo, buy alcohol, and all the rest of it. So it's very, very different settings for those within those 2 years. I'm really interested in I think it was Karen that mentioned around the European Convention that doesn't require such a scheme. I'd like you to develop that point and whether it relates to the age difference. How does this sit with the specific safeguarding concerns that some people may have over this, and also with the European Convention? And do you think that parental consent should be required? And what are your views? I'll start with Naomi.
So far as parental consent is concerned, I would say yes, parental consent should be required. In general, the people who know a child best and can be best trusted to keep that child's interests at the forefront of their minds will be the child's parents. So the default position should be parental consent. But that seems to me to be a very unfortunate and inadequate safeguard in itself against this invitation to children to make life-changing decisions that they may subsequently regret or that may set them on a path to harm. So yes, a reduction in the age limit with parental consent doesn't seem to me to meet the need. There should not be a reduction in the age limit at all. This is not something that any child, anyone who is not yet an adult, should be able to do. And I really, I'm not sure I have much more to say than what I said in answer to my previous question about the importance of having in mind Hilary Cass's concerns about social transition. I would suggest that legal transition is social transition with a great deal more besides. It's going to feel, it's bound to feel to any child like a very solemn, serious step. It's a permanent declaration of intent with legal effects. And children under the age of 18, as you've just said, can't get tattoos. This is a much more serious, life-changing step for a child to take than getting a tattoo. And yet the adults around a child think it their duty to protect a child from making that sort of step, at least without parental consent.
Review in a minute, but Karen, if you'd like to come in.
Just in relation to age, I probably can't help you very much. Intuitively, I feel 16 years old is very young indeed, but it's been a very long time since I had a child, and I'm not a children's expert, and so intuition wouldn't be a good enough reason or a good enough basis for me to make a contribution to a committee like this. I think it's I would reserve that for somebody with the relevant expertise. As to Article 8, which I think I'm more qualified to speak about, I hope so anyway, Article 8 does require a system under which the state recognises a change in sex. So there must be a system. What it doesn't require is a particular system. So the European Court of Human Rights has said there's a margin of discretion, as they describe it. So each state is entitled to determine what its own scheme might be. There must be a scheme, but it doesn't require a scheme like this, for example, or like that proposed. And it's perhaps an important context to note, and I think Naomi alluded to this, that all the cases so far under Article 8... and indeed, as decided by the European Court of Justice, in terms of EU law, have determined cases concerning transsexuals, as they've been described, that is, people who've undergone a process of medical diagnosis and surgical transition. I'm not suggesting for a moment that surgical transition ought to be required, and I'm not suggesting that, but it is of note that in those cases where the European Court says there must be a system of recognition, they've all been cases where there has been very significant physical change and medical oversight.
Pick you up on that point. So does that mean that if a scheme, and we're calling it a scheme in your words, was insufficient or it was inadequate or it didn't, it had an absence of procedural safeguards, does that mean that it's infringing the Article 8 of the European Convention?
It may do. So, for example, let's take an extreme example. If there was a scheme that said you must have intrusive medical intervention, surgery, plus you have to wait 10 years and then you have to pay £5,000, in my view, the European Court would inevitably say that is not a meaningful scheme because it precludes many people who can properly be described as trans, either under a medical diagnosis or some other objective threshold, and so wouldn't be a meaningful scheme. I'm reassured because I can see Sharon nodding away next to me. But that would be the position in my view.
Sharon, do you want to come in on?
Yeah, I actually understood your question slightly differently, so I forgive me if I've misinterpreted it, but what I thought you were asking was if we tried to introduce a scheme that didn't have safeguards to protect young people from transitioning at too early an age, would that contravene Article 8? Was that what you were asking?
Yeah.
So it doesn't. I'm hopefully Karen would agree with this because I think you are more you're closer to the actually working with Article 8 on a daily basis than I am. That wouldn't be how Article 8 would work. It would be the opposite way around. So if a child felt that they weren't getting access to proper treatment through a system that recognised their identity, they could make an Article 8 claim. So I agree with Karen that at the moment, the way that the European Court of Human Rights has interpreted the need to have some system for recognition still allows for some margin of appreciation to the UK and other states because there is no broad consensus on what a model of gender recognition should look like, and there are lots of different models across Europe and the rest of the world. But I guess I would draw the committee's attention to the fact that that was also the case in 2004, before the Gender Recognition Act, when the UK was in the company of Ireland, Andorra and Albania as the only European nations who didn't have a proper system of gender recognition. At that point in time, the European Court on Human Rights had also given the UK a margin of appreciation, but eventually they were such an outlier that they were said to be in breach of human rights law, and that was why we got the Gender Recognition Act in the first place. So I guess what I'm saying is, although we have a margin of appreciation, does Scotland want to kind of lag around at the minimal edge of the threshold, doing what's necessary in a minimalist way, or do we want to be a leader in trying to come up with a system that is reflective of all these international and national changes about gender dysphoria, age and so on? If I can come to the age question that you asked, I also am not a specialist in this area. I know you've heard from the Commissioner for Children and Young People and various other people who are specialists in this area. I would just draw the committee's attention to the Age of Legal Capacity Scotland Act from 1991 that says that a young person aged 16 or over can consent to lots of things, including life-changing medical treatment. So not just a document that changes your sex or gender, but actual life-saving treatment like a heart transplant or so on, which is a lot more serious than a tattoo at the age of 18. So that's what I would say in answer to that question.
I think that in terms of the sort of the committee's work, I think it's important that we are able to understand the legal implications, from the point of view of someone who has that specialist ability to comment on that, and I don't expect you to be able to do that, but perhaps it's something that we should consider. Accessing clinical treatment for life-saving treatment is maybe slightly different to accessing puberty blockers. So it's something that perhaps we should develop with somebody who is a specific case law expert in child.
Right, but of course, the issue is that this bill has nothing to do with puberty blockers. The bill that's before the committee doesn't say anything about puberty blockers. I understand that there's a disagreement and ongoing research and discussion about the place of puberty blockers in treatment for the trans people who want that sort of treatment, but that is not what the bill before us is discussing.
May I just respond very briefly to something Sharon said? I spoke about the need for a system under Article 8, whatever that system might look like. And I think Sharon, if I understood her correctly, was saying that wouldn't address a situation where a child had received recognition. In other words, would that engage Article 8? In my view, there might be circumstances where granting a gender recognition certificate to a child with all the consequences that might flow might violate Article 8 because it intrudes upon their sense of identity, their personality, and may have longer term consequences like which school they're going to, how they identify, and so on. So it may do without proper procedural safeguards in any event. And again, I can see Sharon nodding, so I'm reassured by that.
Well, I think actually I was just thinking that not so much that I was agreeing entirely with your point, but I can see the argument that you're making.
Can I make just two very short additional points on the CAS review? Dr. Hilary Cass has been commissioned to undertake a thorough review of the treatment of gender dysphoria in children. And this isn't just about medical treatment in the shape of puberty blockers, because she is also considering, and she's already mentioned in her interim report, the consequences of social transition and the fact that that's a serious intervention. The main thing I would say in relation to Cass is wait. She hasn't finished her job yet. She needs to be able to finish her job. We need to understand the implications of that for children's needs and the treatment of children presenting with gender dysphoria before any such radical change ought to be made, allowing children to change their legal sex. And the other point is just to endorse very strongly what you've said about the importance of this committee hearing from a lawyer specialising in child protection, because there will be issues that need to be explored that none of us here are, have the specific expertise for.
Convener, if I may, Naomi, can I just pick up on something you said in your opening statement there about affecting the legal status of a Scottish-born 16-year-old accessing services in England? What did you mean by that? Was that specifically on education?
Not necessarily specifically in education. I mean, one of the areas of greatest difficulty, to my mind, in this bill is the whole question of cross-border effects. Those who are entitled to apply are those whose birth was registered in Scotland, so Scottish-born children, or resident in Scotland, which I don't think we know exactly what means for how long you have to be resident before you're entitled to apply. But it's certainly going to be the case, if this goes through, that there will be children who have a Scottish GRC but are living resident in England and going to English school or England and Wales or the rest of the UK and are going to schools and need to be accommodated and dealt with. And they have a legal status whose full consequences we simply don't, I certainly simply don't understand. And that's something I suggest needs to be very carefully bottomed out. Are Scottish GRCs portable? Will they have full effect in the rest of the UK? If they don't, what are the consequences of that? Is this an alternative route, or is this, can you have both a rest of UK GRC and a Scottish GRC in parallel? If Scottish GRCs are to have effect in the rest of the UK, does that require action on the part of the Westminster government? Do you require action under Section 4 of the Scotland Act? All of those are difficult questions, and they don't seem to have been bottomed out, and I suggest they very urgently need to be.
For fairness, I think it's important that I just ask the other witnesses regarding the CAS review. I just wondered whether you had any opinion about the interim CAS review and whether you believe that the GRR should be paused to reflect the publication. Karen?
I would say absolutely. I mean, this is a major piece of work, looking at the impact on children, and I think it would be very unfortunate if the committee, the bill were enacted without the benefit of the outcome of the final report.
My understanding is that there's already been a children's rights and welfare impact assessment of the bill, is that correct? And that looking at other jurisdictions where this has been done hasn't shown any negative impact on young people. I'm not going to refer to 16-year-olds as a child necessarily. A young person of age 16 or over having it impacted upon any negative effects in other jurisdictions that have done this. So I think there's already evidence that the committee can consider in that respect.
A couple of points from that I want to just pick up on. First of all, obviously, we did invite Dr. Cass. She's declined but has referenced us to her interim report. I think it's worth noting that Dr. Cass's remit was specifically in relation to NHS England. So I think that's just there. But obviously, anyone can look at her report. I think the other point that was made by Rachel and Naomi in relation to specialist evidence around children, I think Naomi talked about lawyers, but I think for anyone watching, I would suggest that they look back at our evidence with the Children and Young People's Commissioner. Obviously, he is not a lawyer, but I guess he had access to lawyers in terms of answering the committee's questions at that point. Moving now on to Pam.
Point of order, please. Sorry, but I wasn't a member of the committee at that point in time. I think it's important to get that in public record.
I think that's why I'm saying that anyone who wants to look at that can look back onto the Scottish Parliament website and can see the evidence that was given. It's obviously in our official report as well. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for the questions that you've answered so far, and also for setting out your opening statements, some pretty clear bits of advice, including on the legal definitions of sex and gender reassignment, which I found particularly helpful, so thank you for that. Thank you also for the evidence you've submitted in advance, which has also been very useful. I want to explore a little bit more about the impact of a gender recognition certificate on single-sex spaces. And I know that we've spent quite a bit of time talking about the effect of a gender recognition certificate in that regard. So we've spoke about, I think, Karen Monaghan, your point around the effect of it and what it means for the exclusion of trans people from single-sex spaces. And you were quite clear about that. So as far as I can understand, what appears to be the kind of issue is around the cohort of people who will be able to access that regardless of the effect of it, if that makes sense. So there's a legal effect which doesn't appear to change as a result of this act, but that more people will have access to that legal route is my understanding of what you've said. And if I've misunderstood it, please do correct me. So could you tell us a bit about who you think the cohort of people will be? We have heard some evidence so far that it's unlikely to be a group of new trans people, but that in fact it is likely to be an existing group of trans people who haven't yet considered accessing a gender recognition certificate because of the troubles with accessing one. So could you tell us a little bit about who you think that cohort will be? And also, if they are, my understanding from the evidence that we've had already is that those people who do not have a gender recognition certificate are currently accessing single-sex spaces. Women's Aid have, and others have given evidence on how they operate those. And some of whom, some of the people that that we're talking about here as well don't have gender dysphoria, but still would like legal recognition of their sex. So could you talk a bit about the cohort of people and whether or not who you think they are and how you think their rights to access single-sex spaces will be changed?
Is that addressed to me first?
Probably all three of you, but yeah. Feel free to go first, Naomi.
Thank you. My view is a bit complicated on what the legal effect is, because my view ultimately is that the sex in the Equality Act, it means biological sex. So a gender recognition certificate doesn't change it. And that means that in formal terms, if I'm right, and we just don't know whether or not I'm right on this, but if I'm right, in formal terms, the grant of a gender recognition certificate will make no difference at all to legal entitlement. I don't think I can talk usefully about legal entitlement to access single-sex spaces. It's much more likely to be the other way around, legal ability of those running them to exclude. So my view is that if a set space or service is within the single-sex exceptions in the Equality Act, because sex in the Equality Act means biological sex, if you have permission to exclude all male people, that means all male people, including those who self-identify as women and including those who have a gender recognition certificate defining them as female. But that's not the end of the answer by any means, and that's the cause of my particular caution and my fear that this proposed change may operate in quite a cruel way to the group that it's intending to help, because it will create an expectation. It's already the case that there is a widespread belief that because people with a protected characteristic of gender reassignment are entitled not to suffer discrimination on that ground, it follows that they must be entitled to access all single-sex spaces provided for the opposite sex, or it follows that they must be entitled to be treated for all purposes as if they were the opposite sex. And, of course, that's not the case. The entitlement not to suffer discrimination on grounds of gender reassignment means, for example, that you can't be excluded from the men's toilets because you're, if you're a trans-identifying male, because you can't be told, no, you can't come in here because you're trans. But what you can be told is, no, you can't come into this female-only space because you're not female. Even if you feel female, even if you identify as female, even if you have a gender recognition certificate that says you're female, still, this is a female-only space. But that's sex discrimination. That's not gender reassignment discrimination. So the protection from gender reassignment discrimination, quite importantly, doesn't provide protection from exclusion from services and spaces provided for the opposite sex. But the problem that we have is that it's very widely believed that it does. And providing gender recognition certificates to a much wider group. And there's a wide belief that if you're trans at all, you're entitled to use spaces and services provided for the opposite sex. And there's probably an even wider belief that if you have a gender recognition certificate, that entitlement is even stronger. The world has to treat you as if you were the sex you wish you were. And I think that's legally wrong, but that expectation is going to be created. And then that expectation, best of my belief, is going to be disappointed there will be litigation, there will be bitterly fought litigation on these questions. And my expectation is that the final outcome of that litigation will be that all those people who were given a gender recognition certificate, that much wider cohort, who had something that they very much wanted, they thought promised to them, will ultimately be disappointed of it. And that's a worry.
Can I just press you on that point? Do you think that people accessing a gender recognition certificate are doing it with the main purpose of accessing single-sex spaces? Because if that's the case, then what you're saying may indeed be the case. I'm not sure if that bears out in international evidence, but I could see how it would be the case. But a number of trans people have said that it isn't about their access to single-sex spaces. Some have even said that, you know, they recognise that could be difficult in some circumstances. But in fact, it's about being recognised in the gender that they live when they die, or when they go for a job, or when they go to university. Do you have evidence to suggest that people are accessing it for those other purposes?
I don't think we have any evidence at all. We simply don't know. We already don't really know what people are accessing gender recognition certificates form. We certainly have very little way of guessing at the motivations, and no doubt there will be a wide range of motivations and a wide range of backgrounds and background circumstances behind people's access to new self-ID gender recognition certificates. I think that's one of the most troubling things about this bill, that it creates a much greater level of uncertainty, both as to the nature of the new class of gender recognition certificate holders. We simply don't know who they're going to be. And also the size of it. We don't know how many there are going to be.
So do you therefore think that the people who various different bits of research have identified as trans but don't yet have a GRC, do you think there are missing people in that? And if you do, who are those people that you think will come forward for a gender recognition certificate that are not yet known to any services or organisations?
I don't see how we know the answer to that question. If you're saying you can have a gender recognition certificate because you say on the basis of self-identification, you make it very easy for anyone who wants one for any purpose. But I would be very surprised if that purpose wasn't sometimes identity laundering.
Okay.
So, and that's a particular worry.
I mean, you yourself have called the process, I think you said, solemn and serious. Mm. So do you think if it is a solemn and serious process, which is to access a gender recognition certificate, that people will do that? Use it for those purposes?
Yes, I do. I think some people have very strong reasons for wanting to launder their identities. You know, there are criminals as well as good, well-meaning people in the world, and we need to have laws that are robust to people with bad intentions, as well as we can't make law on the assumption that everyone who might possibly use this law is going to do so with the best of intentions. They have to be robust to bad intentions too, and I think there are a range of bad intentions that could be facilitated by these changes.
Question for you, and then I will move on to others. Sorry. Do you think that those people and those bad actors, and I agree there will be some people who want to harm women, do you think that they feel they need a gender recognition certificate to do it?
No. The problem with making gender recognition certificates much easier to obtain is it will create a greater sense of entitlement, a larger class of people who have this secret certificate in their filing cabinets that nobody dares ask them about because of the potential criminal penalties for disclosing what you know. I'm sorry, I've lost track of the question.
It was in recognition of the fact that there will be people who seek to harm women, and there have been for forever.
Do
you think they'll need a gender recognition certificate to do so?
Yes. I mean, what we are seeing is a steady erosion of the ability to protect single-sex spaces on the basis that they're simply obviously single-sex. So if you say anyone who identifies as a woman can have a gender recognition certificate and give the impression, and the impression will be widely given, that especially anyone with a gender recognition certificate is entitled to access any single-sex service, and nobody can deny them that, then you create a situation in which it's impossible ever to challenge someone who oughtn't to be there. You see someone who looks like a man, and you don't know whether he identifies as a woman. You don't know whether he might have a gender recognition certificate. He may be dressed as a woman, but you don't know whether he's an erotic cross-dresser, a trans person with gender dysphoria but no gender recognition certificate, somebody fully medically transitioned with a gender recognition certificate. You don't know what his status is, but you ought to be able to say, these are my boundaries. I've consented to take my clothes off, or whatever it is, in this space that I've been told is a women-only space. And it's the impact on me that matters. It's the impact on the general user of that space that matters. And this actually takes me back to a point about indirect discrimination and justification. It has been suggested that excluding males from women-only spaces across the board might amount to indirect discrimination on grounds of gender reassignment. And in purely numerical terms, that's highly possible, maybe probable. But in terms of justification, once you think about the proportionality of the fact that as soon as you've admitted one male person to a space where women want to take their clothes off, to take an example, you have spoiled it for all the women. You have made it it is no longer a women-only space. It's not single-sex, it's mixed. So when you're looking at the proportionality, the justification of maintaining single-sex spaces, it seems to me pretty much inevitable that you're always going to come to the same conclusion. As soon as you admit one man or one male person identifying as female, It is no longer a single-sex space, it's a mixed space, and it's lost all its purpose. No woman can be confident that it's a single-sex space, so justification is always going to be in place. Sorry, I may have drifted a little from your question, but I think I answered it at the start.
Thank you, and that's no problem at all. It seems to be the case with a lot of the discussion on this issue, to be honest. Karen, do you have anything further to add?
If I can just clarify a couple of things and then say... talk about the cohort, if I may. And I do this because of your observation about women's aid. As to the provisions in relation to single-sex services, first of all, they're permissive. So nobody has to set up a single-sex service. In other words, if you're a counselling service, let's say, sexual violence counselling service, you don't have to become a single-sex, plainly. And secondly... where you are a single-sex service, the starting point is that those without a GRC can be excluded if they're not of the sex that the service is serving. So a trans woman without a GRC can be excluded from a female-only service. Just for clarity, there may be circumstances where justification is required, but it's complex, and the key issue is the starting point is you can be excluded. Permissive. Don't have to be excluded. So Women's Aid can say, we want to be a single-sex service, but we want to be trans-inclusive. That's permissible. But similarly, a service may say, we're a single-sex service, and we want to, and we lawfully can, exclude trans women without a GRC. So it's permissive. Secondly, as to the cohort, and I've got one small point in addition to this, the answer is we don't know who the cohort will be, because what we know now is there are a small number, 300 or so a year, of people who obtain a GRC. We don't know who the cohort or the size of the cohort, if the bill is enacted, but we can assume it's much larger, because one of the complaints about the present system is that people can't access a GRC where they want one. So we can assume it's much larger. Who they will be, we don't know, because there's no gatekeeping, no threshold, no medical intervention or objective assessment. Living as a woman, as I've already said, gives rise to the sorts of stereotyping we've spoken about. What does living as a woman mean? I don't know. Fourthly, I would just like to say, and this is really in case I forget it, so it's slightly off point, but if I may, we must also not lose track of women from minority communities who may be especially impacted by liberal rules in relation to GRCs. And they are often the most vulnerable women and who access services, sometimes, you know, gatekeep, if you like, through other services, health and so on. So please, I would invite the committee to be extremely mindful of that.
Yes, I'd like to come back in and second that, bearing in mind that standards of modesty for different communities are widely varying.
And sorry, I'm just conscious of time and I'm keen to hear from... Karen, can I just ask you one other question about that? We've heard from people who consider who are trans but who don't have gender dysphoria. So what could we do to allow them to access a gender recognition certificate, which is incredibly important for them?
Yeah. And that's what I was indicating at the beginning. If we accept that gender dysphoria isn't really a medical condition and ought not to be recognised as such, and I've heard Sharon about that, how do we identify who's trans? And that is problematic. Living as a woman cannot be the threshold. I don't know what that means. Do I live as a woman? I wear trousers, I've got short hair, you know, I might be said to be gender non-conforming in a broad sense. So I don't know what that means. And I think the committee, if I may say so with respect, need to be careful about setting an objective standard, and which is one that is capable of being determined within a legal scheme. There has to be a degree of legal certainty. So if the committee is moving away from gender dysphoria, then I would invite the committee to consider how some objective assessment, how we know what a trans person is and how they meet the threshold.
Is there an example in international law that you could suggest to us?
No, but Sharon may be able to.
Thank you.
Certainly within the context of the Equality Act, which is my area of expertise, I would be very concerned if there weren't an objective threshold, which means that there would be a wide cohort of uncertain people accessing women's spaces that may disadvantage some of the most vulnerable women, victims of sexual violence, for example, and women from minority groups.
Thank you. And just, finally, Sharon, just if
sorry, just coming in very shortly on that.
Sorry, be mindful of time, I'm sorry. So, Pam, I think, was wanting to ask Sharon now.
Thank you. Sorry, Naomi. Sharon, do you have anything to add on this particular point?
There's so much in your question to talk about. I'll try to be brief and to the point. Who is the cohort of people, is the first question you asked, that might want to access a GRC who are currently not doing so? I think that's true to say that we don't know exactly, but we can look to other jurisdictions that have introduced these systems of more accessible GRC certificates for people. And I think what we can say about that is there might be an initial uptick in those going forward with the GRC process, because it is going to be easier for people, and the current system does put people off, as we know, as you've heard from other people. But there's no evidence from other jurisdictions that there's a sudden mad rush of people to of thousands of people to get GRCs. So although we don't know, and I can't say that for sure, we do have some evidence from other jurisdictions that would point in that direction. I don't want to get into this in a lot of detail because it would take a long time and it's a super complex area of law, but my understanding of the equality legislation actually differs quite markedly from the understandings that have already been presented to you today. My understanding is that it doesn't matter whether you have a GRC or not, you can still be excluded from a single-sex space, because the Equality Act itself does not say in the Act that you either must have or must not have a GRC in order to be excluded. So the current law already allows a single-sex space or sex-segregated space to exclude somebody, whether or not they have a GRC, if they meet the correct legal threshold, which I'm sure you have heard, is a proportionate legitimate aim and so on. And so in terms of whether or not people can still be excluded after this proposed system, if it were introduced, that part of the law remains unchanged. People could still be excluded whether or not they had a GRC. If there are more people with GRCs, then potentially there are more people who could be excluded. But again, the bar for exclusion is high. What does it mean to live as a woman? I often spend an entire semester talking to my students about what does it mean to live as a woman. That is an incredibly complicated question. I am, as much as anybody, as suspicious as sceptical of gender stereotypes. But it cannot simply just be the reproductive bits that you have. Feminists for decades have been arguing that we should not reduce what it means to be a woman to our reproductive organs, to our bodily autonomy and so on. And so therefore, an understanding of what it means to live as a woman is complex, is nuanced, is maybe not something we can capture in a bill or an act. But from my perspective, from the perspective of much feminist research, it cannot simply be just biological elements. That's my view. Thanks.
Thank you.
And Naomi, you want to come back in just very, very briefly, because we've got two more folk and you might have... They maybe want to cover some of this area, so don't take it too wide, because other folk are wanting to cover areas.
The point I wanted to put in at this point is that specific sensitivities to women who've suffered sexual violence are, of course, necessary. But that shouldn't be confined, that mustn't be confined to services specifically for those women. The problem is that we don't know, nobody knows, at the swimming pool, at the gym, at the public toilets, at the library, wherever, you don't know which women using those services have suffered sexual violence, which women are traumatised, carry trauma from male violence. And they need to be able to use those services freely without making a declaration about their past. So you should, as a traumatised woman who has suffered sexual violence, be able to use the loo at the library, for example, without having those traumas triggered. And I think that's a very important point to bear in mind. It's the needs of sexual abuse survivors aren't confined to specific services for those groups.
So, and Sharon would like to come in very, very quickly, and then we'll go to Pam
Dossal. I don't have any disagreement with that. I think that's right. That's, you know, we don't know how people experience sexual abuse in the community more generally, and that needs to be taken into account. I just wanted to just point the committee in the direction of a piece of research that was done at the University of California on testing whether or not opening up laws to protect trans people have an impact on the rates of reported violence in toilets and changing rooms and bathrooms and so on. And they're the first piece of research to do that. They found that the passage of non-discrimination law is not related to the number or frequency of criminal incidents in public spaces. They did a massive piece of research, and that the reports of violations in bathrooms and locker rooms are exceedingly rare. As a feminist researcher who works in sexual violence, I know a lot of violence goes unreported. This study is only looking at reported violence, but it still indicates that there is no connection between opening up anti-discrimination laws and reports of violence in those kinds of spaces. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Pam Gossel, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you for your opening statements and the information you've provided. I certainly have found it very knowledgeable, especially the stuff you spoke about, Karen, breaking it down where a GRC certificate applies and where it doesn't, and obviously gender and sex. My question follows on from what my colleague Pam's just said. It's in relation to the bill, because we've heard many concerns of people that are opposed to the bill in relation to the self-including, excluding, using those single-sex services. And it's mostly in relation to, I know you've spoke quite a bit about this, but it's in relation to the female representation on public boards and in sport. Obviously, you've heard about sport, the fact is it an unfair or fair playing field. And also in relation to what you've touched on, Karen and Naomi, you've touched on the minority groups, how it will actually impact on women of faith. So you've discussed this, obviously, and just a little bit more detail on that. What do you see the solution, especially in relation to the sport question and the women of faith, and how we must be, you know, mindful not to exclude anybody out there, and make sure that with this bill they don't feel excluded? Yeah. For yourself, Karen, first.
Okay. First of all, there is an exclusion in relation to sport already that allows for women with a gender recognition certificate, so trans women with or without a gender recognition certificate, to be excluded or to be not allowed to participate in sports, in women's teams, for example. The reason for that is, of course, bodily strength and so on. So there is an exception in place that doesn't depend upon whether or not a trans woman has a GRC. They can be excluded from competitive sports where their body means that it would be unfair. So running, for example. So there is that exception. It's a different exception. And it applies whether or not a person has a GRC. As to the representation, for example, that seems to me to be very important, along with equal pay, which I don't know whether you've spoken about. But in terms of representation, there are positive action measures in the Equality Act which allow, for example, positive action to address a lack of participation or the overcoming of disadvantage. Now, the more likely a person has a GRC, the more likely they will be, therefore, or inevitably, the more likely there will be a larger cohort of trans women. And I only use trans women because that's the controversy, but of course I mean it the other way. There will be a larger cohort of people who are able to identify as females and take advantage of positive action measures, including those that have been directed at females because of historic disadvantage. Now, trans women may well experience historic disadvantage as well, but for different reasons. So for females, those biological women who've lived as women for the whole of their lives, gone through the education system as girls, experienced the disadvantage that girls often experience, like being rooted into different courses, non-sciences and so on, there may be positive action measures directed at them, but trans women with GRCs will become entitled because they will fall within the cohort of women to whom eventually these provisions are addressed, even though they may not be the disadvantaged group. Similarly, if I may just say equal pay, because that hasn't been, and I'll just do it in 2 minutes, I see the time, but I don't think it's been mentioned. Of course, once you have a person with a gender recognition certificate, trans woman again, using that example, they will be treated as female for the purposes of determining whether or not there are disparities in pay. So if you have three women and a trans woman who appear to have lower pay than a man, that trans woman has gone through their career as a male and so has comparable pay to the male, it may obscure inequality in pay between, not sure I've expressed that very well, but I hope you understand what I mean. You're looking at average pay. If you have a trans woman who has gone through their career as a male, their pay will be higher and may conceal disparities between men and women pay, particularly when we've got the sorts of, I mean, you've had it in Scotland, you know, local authority pay disparities and so on. So that's an issue the committee should just be alive to, in my my observation, and perhaps think about that.
Karen, just a little bit on the minority groups, obviously that's yes. Other area.
So sorry, that was the other area. Yes, as I've said, where a trans woman has a gender recognition certificate, then they can't be excluded from a female space unless that female space is able to meet the threshold of justification. It might be a small organisation, for example. If you've got a small sexual advice, a small sexual counselling service, for example, or a swimming facility that's used commonly by minority women, they may not be able to use that facility if trans women are admitted. Now, there's no point saying, well, they ought not to think that, or that ought not to happen. That is the reality. And often they're the most marginalised communities, certainly in some areas, the most marginalised, and they may be excluded from certain services if trans women are permitted access. Now, as I've said, trans women can be excluded, even with a GRC, where there's justification, but there's a threshold that has to be met. And care, great care must be taken, it seems to me, on ensuring that all members of the community, all women, are not excluded from services. So again, I would invite the committee to think about that.
Thank you. Naomi, can you just touch a little bit on the women of faith here? The fact that if it's a religion or certain things, you've probably heard in past committee meetings we've discussed this, that how do we feel them not feeling excluded, whether it's in a swimming changing room, are they going backwards? The fact that, you know, we have heard in a private session, I'm not allowed to say this, say that it's just a little bit about the fact that people shopping online and going into changing rooms, and then they decide that, hold on, we just shop online, so we don't want to go out to a changing room in case somebody else is there. So it's just on that, how do we make sure that everybody's included, not excluded there? Naomi, just a little bit on that.
I think this is a huge problem and insufficiently examined so far. That if you make all single-sex spaces and services in effect mixed spaces because you... Or mixed spaces from the point of view of women with particular beliefs and women from particular faith groups... then you are liable to create a situation where women in those groups are effectively excluded from all kinds of aspects of public life. They won't, which may be necessary to their inclusion in society as full members of a democracy. Maybe they may be denied access to the library because they can't go far enough from home without using the loo, and they can't be confident that the toilet is a single-sex space. They may not use the gym, which is important to their health, because they've attended a women-only swimming session, without which they might not feel comfortable or might even not have permission of their families to attend the swimming pool. They find a trans-identifying male in that swimming session and they leave and they never come back. And we won't necessarily know about these effects. We'll just create a gradual chilling effect where women from certain sections of society simply self-exclude. And possibly the worst of those is self-exclusion from rape crisis and domestic violence services, because that really is piling disadvantage on disadvantage. If an abused or sexually traumatised woman can't access the services that she needs because she can't feel, she doesn't have the comfort of knowing that when they say single sex, they mean single sex and they mean what she means by single sex, then she may be excluded, and that may be whole populations. And I think we need to think about the proportions here. And that takes me on to some of the positive action measures in which a similar point arises. It makes sense to have positive action to seek to equalise the representation of men and women on various public in various contexts and public functions. So, for example, the provisions about single-sex shortlists. That makes sense because the population is divided into two roughly equal halves, men and women. You couldn't have any comparable provision to ensure proportionate representation of trans people in those sorts of circumstances. It would make no sense because the numbers are far too small. And we notice that you can notice that from the fact that we only have those provisions in relation to men and women. So if you allow individuals who have self-identified as women to take the places that have been reserved for women on shortlists or what, public boards or what have you, then you reduce the opportunities for women, and you undermine the very purpose for which those provisions were made. And you do so in a way that I would suggest is fundamentally unfair.
Thank you. I was just going to ask Sharon.
Yeah, if you do that first, then I know Pam Duncan-Glancy wants to come in for a small point, and then Rachel.
Sharon, I just wanted to ask you, obviously, we've heard quite a lot from Naomi and Karen. Just, is there a solution to this? Is there something that we can have this happy medium that we don't exclude anybody and that we make sure everybody's included?
I think it's a really complex question. I think that intersecting categories of human experience like race, religion, disability, nationality, citizenship, they're all really important issues that we need to pay attention to how they work together to compound different forms of discrimination and so on. And trying to finally balance those, I think, is often best left to the people who provide those services. So, for example, I would want to defer to someone like Shakti Women's Aid to have, I don't know if you've heard from them, but to services like that who provide services for women of colour or particular religions, but some of whom actually will be trans themselves also, and some of whom are Indian, Muslim and trans. And so how to deal with these really important culturally sensitive issues, I think, is probably something to talk to those kinds of organisations who manage those kinds of issues all the time. That would be what I would say.
Well, Sharon, we have heard privately from one of those organisations, right. And they have talked about it. It was just more on the religious side, that when they actually come outside, not the service, but when they use places, that how do we make sure everybody's included?
I think that maybe using the guidance from those organisations in those contexts could be broadened out more generally. We could learn from those in a more public environment through, you know, local government and so on. So I don't think the kinds of solutions that they come up with should be confined only to the women's sector. There are lessons that we could learn from more generally in society, I think.
Thank you, Sharon. So it's very important that we hear from these organisations to make sure this bill includes everybody and represents everybody in Scotland.
Could I just come back on one other thing that came up there, which was about the proportionate representation of smaller groups? And I just wanted to say that I understand all the arguments for, all women shortlists or 50-50 and so on. I think it's problematic from my perspective to say that it's not possible to do proportionate representation of smaller groups, because otherwise we wouldn't be able to think about race or religion or other protected characteristics where people are represented in a much smaller number percentage of the community, we wouldn't be able to think about imaginative ways of protecting them if we didn't think more broadly about proportionately trying to represent smaller groups. That was the only point I wanted to make. Thanks.
And a brief supplementary from Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to reflect very briefly, Naomi, on your comments about women worrying about whether or not there's going to be a toilet they can access safely. And I just want to say on the record that as a disabled woman, I experienced that, as I'm sure everyone around here will know. It is a horrible thing to worry about whether you're going to be able to access a toilet or not. So we need to get this right. But I can only also imagine that trans women will go through and trans men will go through a similar experience about when they leave the house and whether they're going to be able to access a toilet or a changing room. Would you agree that perhaps part of the solution to this is that we have inclusive and private spaces?
Absolutely, yes. For toilet provision, it really shouldn't be very hard. Either there need to be fully private facilities for everyone, in which case sex simply doesn't arise, or else there needs to be men's and women's and unisex, fully private for anyone who isn't comfortable using the men's or the women's. So once you've got that third space, or else full privacy, the problem is solved.
I suggested a third space, but I take the point about the privacy. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. And Rachel, brief
clarification,
as well.
Convener. Yeah. It's just I'm noticing that obviously that, and I respect the differences that Naomi and Sharon have, and Karen somewhere in the middle of. But I just wanted to ask on the legislative competence of expanding the legal definition of a woman. I mean, we can't do that, can we? In terms of the examples that you're giving, in terms of gender representation. So on Sharon's point, how you use the term reduced to biological sex, I don't really understand how that can be interpreted in law.
Can I perhaps usefully try to answer that? I think the case that you're referring to is the judicial review of the gender representation.
Well, you're using the gender representation example. Yes.
So I think the court was really clear in that case in saying it would have been open to the Scottish Government to protect trans people by making provision for them to be represented on public boards, but it would have had to have been done under the heading of gender reassignment, not under the heading of sex. So that's what I'm saying is we can protect people, whether it's on the basis of religion or race or gender reassignment, even if they're small populations, we can think of imaginative ways to protect them and involve them in public life. And all that court case was saying was not that we can't do that, but the way that the government had tried to do it was wrong because it had gone beyond its legislative competence in changing the definition of women.
Do you have any further comments?
Yes, I don't think I have a concluded view about whether what's proposed is within the Scottish Parliament's legislative competence. I think that's an extraordinarily difficult and complicated question. But I certainly think it's far from clear that the answer is yes. The worry is that in legislating in the way proposed, you will create a situation, you will make law that's open to challenge, either from Westminster or from by way of third-party challenge. And that will be bad for certainty and undesirable in all kinds of ways. So it's certainly not clear.
I meant clarification, but it ended up growing arms and legs, and I think it could go on.
Thanks very much. And I think folk were pretty brief there, so thanks for that. Emma Roddick, please.
Quite a lot of my questions we've gone through in great detail, so I'll try avoid retreading. But Naomi, the comments around self-ID and concerns that could mean expanding the group of people who would be able to obtain a GRC. Previous witnesses, I'm aware, have come to this committee and described the current process as discriminatory. So if there are barriers to people who don't have a lot of money behind them or who live in somewhere that doesn't have easy access to gender identity services, is it not incumbent upon us to do exactly that and expand the group of people who are able to obtain a GRC?
Well, so far as money is concerned, I think I'm right in recalling that the fee has now come down to £5 anyway. And I think even that fee can be remitted on proof of hardship. But I'm not sure I remember that exactly right. So I don't think financial hardship is likely to be a significant concern. I suppose my answer to that is simply that there need to be clear criteria. We need to know what the conditions are that justify the grant of a gender recognition certificate, because it has these quite far-reaching effects and consequences. And if it is simply, in effect, available on request, I think that is capable of having some very damaging effects. So I don't think it's about discriminating against any particular group. It's just about it's about gatekeeping in the best sense. This, you know, before you provide benefits to people, people need to show that they need them or show that they're entitled to them. And this particular sort of benefit, a state recognition of a new official sex, legal sex, is something that it's reasonable to expect some quite serious proof of entitlement to. So yes, that's true of many things. I don't think it's peculiar to trans people.
I think certainly at the moment, just to clarify on the financial side, the current, you know, gatekeeping includes the need to access these services, which can be financially prohibitive, then going and seeking the medical proof of what you've been through can also have fees associated with it. So I think there are a lot of recognised financial sides to going through the process as it currently exists, besides, you know, the actual applying for and paying the £5. So that's more what I was referring to. And if trans people are coming forward and saying that these barriers do exist for them, and I invite Karen to respond to this as well, do we not have a duty to take those barriers down?
Well, I mean, this is moving a bit beyond my expertise, but my understanding is that the Scottish NHS is still the envy of those of us south of the border. It shouldn't involve expense to access a diagnosis of gender dysphoria. Yes, it's tempting to say it would be nice to remove barriers for people having whatever they want, but if whatever they want has consequences for other people, which I think you've heard a gender recognition certificate can have, then we can't simply remove all barriers. We need to know that people are entitled.
Just really to repeat what I've already said, I completely accept there are difficulties with the GRA as it presently is drafted. I also think there are difficulties with the concept of a diagnosis of gender dysphoria. So I'm not suggesting there isn't room for improvement at all. What concerns me is the absence of any objective assessment of who might be trans and who therefore might be entitled to a gender recognition certificate, and no gatekeeping as we've described it, and the impact on the Equality Act and the cohort of people who might be able to access single-sex services.
And if you sweep away the requirement for a medical diagnosis, it's very difficult to see what you're left with. What else could it be? What is it to be trans?
I suppose I was going to move on to that just slightly, because there have been quite a few comments around, you know, the need for a standard to be met or for some proof to be standardised. The experience of trans people, though, is as diverse as cisgender people. So is it possible, while also, you know, respecting trans people's right for privacy and dignity, to prescribe an experience that they must go through or must prove in order to have their identity recognised by the state?
Well, this takes me back to my difficulty with what does trans mean. Unless we have a clear definition of that, it's hard to make sense of statements like trans people are a diverse group. because we don't know what criteria you have to meet to be in that group. So I struggle with that.
Yeah, I suppose that's kind of my point, is the only connecting theme in trans people is that they've changed their gender. So we can't say, well, you must have done this as well. But moving on to some other things I wanted to pick up. Naomi, in terms of your comments on children transitioning and the long-term effects on their life of changing gender, do you have any reflections on the long-term effects of, you know, 16 to 18-year-olds very often moving on to, you know, a new life at university or so on, having to start that life living in a gender that is not theirs?
That the question does rather assume an answer or a premise that I wouldn't necessarily accept. You say, think about the effects for a child of having to start a new life at university or away from home in a gender that is not theirs. But I say, think very hard about what you mean by that and whether a 16 or 17-year-old is sufficiently mature and adult to know if they want to know that they want to, and you say a gender that is not theirs, but they have a body, and their body is necessarily either male or female. So we're certainly talking about adopting a gender expression or a gender identity or something that doesn't conform to their body. So they're moving away from, if you like, the default position. And that's what I say is the radical step. So, and strictly speaking, we're moving off my legal expertise here anyway, so I'm not sure I should go on at length about this. But the default position is people are the sex they are. And if they want to be legally recognised as a different sex, that is a radical step, and that is an even more radical step than the social transition that worries Hilary Cass as a serious intervention for children and young people.
Can I just clarify there then, trying to pin down what you've said, do you believe that a 16-year-old can be trans?
I certainly believe that a 16-year-old can suffer gender dysphoria, and that's clearly the case.
Okay, thank you. That's me, convener.
Okay, thanks very much. No further questions. Well, thanks very much to all three of you. Again, we've gone a little over the time that I think we'd indicated to you, but thanks for giving us your time. Maybe this would have been one of the sessions that would have been better as a roundtable discussion, because I got the feeling that we're getting into that territory. So thanks very much for all your evidence. We'll now suspend for about 5 minutes. Thank you. Okay, thanks very much and welcome back to the meeting. And I welcome to the meeting David Parker, Lead Clinician at the National Gender Identity Clinic Network Scotland. Can I invite David to make a short opening statement, please?
Good morning. Thank you, Convener, Committee, for the invitation to come and speak with you today. The National Gender Identity Clinical Network for Scotland, NGICNS, was established in 2014 to support the implementation of the 2012 Gender Reassignment Protocol and aims to improve access to NHS Scotland trans healthcare services. We're a dynamic group of people representing clinicians, people with lived experience and administrative aspects of trans healthcare in Scotland. Last year, we were invited by the Chief Medical Officer to provide expert support to review this protocol and deliver an updated Scottish pathway for trans healthcare, based upon a human rights person-centred approach and aligning with international standards. This work is well underway. I would like to speak to the experience of people accessing trans healthcare today in Scotland. Waiting times are considerable, with some now at 4 years for an initial appointment. Evidence due to be published shows that a third of people waiting are already accessing medical interventions, including sourcing hormones or surgeries for independent or other providers. Adverse mental health outcomes are a significant concern, and support to those waiting to be seen is crucially important. I want to be very clear today. Our position is that trans and non-binary people are the experts in their own experience. We support the uncoupling of a medical diagnosis from legal gender recognition. We have been grateful for the engagement with Scottish Government representatives in updating and informing us about the proposals for gender recognition and this bill, which we see as a legal and administrative process. The current process to obtain a GRC is seen by many as a complex system to navigate in order to be properly recognised as their authentic selves. We welcome the proposals to make this process more accessible, and I cannot overstate the positive impact this will have on the wellbeing, esteem and sense of equality for trans people. Happy to take questions.
Thanks very much, David. And again, if we start with Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe. Excuse me. It is still good morning. Good morning, David. Thank you for joining us this morning. I've got a couple of questions. Firstly, around the... Can you give us a little bit of a flavour of the kind of support for trans people and others that the clinics provide, just so we know what it is you do?
Yes, of course. So people coming to trans healthcare services in Scotland are more than likely now to be ready, already accessing medical treatment. So a lot of that exploration is something that will have been already well underway. The services we provide are to offer assessment support, to help people understand their experience, to give them as much space and time as they need to determine the interventions that may be appropriate for them and to actually then support them when accessing and exploring those interventions. So we offer a predominantly very trans healthcare specific support. We're not a mental health service. There is, of course, elements of mental health support throughout the service, but predominantly a lot of input that trans people will get will be from mainstream mental health services and third sector organisations, which do excellent work.
Thanks very much. That's helpful. In your opening remarks, you mentioned the support for the reclassification, the World Health Organization's reclassification of gender dysphoria. Could you say a little bit more about that and why it is the network has come to the position it has on that?
Absolutely. So we were first cited on this several years ago when the scientific process was underway to look at classification of gender incongruence, or would then be transsexualism in ICD-10 to what it might become in ICD-11. The scientific papers were consistently pointing to the direction that this is not a, it's certainly not a mental health condition, and arguably isn't a health condition, insofar as should it actually be something in the ICD at all, which is something that's generally defining disease and illness, or is it something that should actually come out of the ICD, as it came to ICD-11. The reason it's remained is predominantly because it's important, I think, in some healthcare systems that a diagnosis is required to access medical interventions that will be essential to help people with gender incongruence. So that was the rationale for keeping it well within the ICD. And it moved, of course, from the mental health chapter into the sexual health chapter, as we know.
And just following on from that, you may not be able to answer this, and I accept that, but in terms of the trans people that the clinics support, how... I'm curious around the kind of relationship that the people you support have with that process of medicalisation, that diagnosis determines or requires. Does that come up in the conversations, in the support discussions that you have?
It does, and there are differences in how people see this. I think for a lot of people it's quite an uncomfortable conversation to say that you're going to talk about diagnosis and coding for somebody when ostensibly you're talking very aspirationally about things that people are trying to understand and very big decisions they're undertaking. And this, the sense of pathologizing this condition for people, I think, is fundamentally wrong. And just reinforces stigma and makes things ever more difficult. There are some situations where people actively seek a diagnosis. I'm thinking particularly, for example, people maybe who are not born in Scotland, who may be looking to change documents elsewhere. There are some legal processes which currently require a diagnosis, and of course the GRC is one of those. So it's a conversation that comes up in different ways,
in
I
different
suppose.
Ways, yeah. And just finally, very quickly, do you see, we've heard in previous sessions that a parallel being drawn around the inclusion of homosexuality in the DSM. With this, do you agree with that parallel, or is there a comment on that? If you don't want to answer that, that's also fine, because I appreciate it is different.
I'm happy to answer. I wasn't going to bring it up because I thought I don't really ever want to link the two as being linked, but actually there's a similarity there, of course, in that I think, I mean, homosexuality came out in, was it 1992? It was removed from the DSM because the evidence suggests that it's not a condition, it's not an illness that should be treated in a medical way. So I agree. I think that's a very, very reasonable comparison.
Thank you. And just for the record, DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistics Manual, isn't it? Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks very much. Thanks for putting that clarification on the record, Maggie, too. Can I go to Fulton McGregor, please?
Yeah, thanks. Good morning to David. Thanks for your opening statement. I've got a couple of questions. I'm just wondering if you could help us out with. I'm just wondering if you can provide any up-to-date information on the current waiting times for an initial appointment at a gender identity clinic and how many people are currently waiting for their initial appointment, because the waiting times is something that has been raised with us in previous sessions.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much for the question. So I've got figures to the end of the final quarter in 21-22, so that's the end of March this year. We have 4,000 people waiting to be seen for an initial appointment in Scotland, just over 4,000 people, of whom 1,037 are young people. People are waiting different times in different parts of Scotland. Most optimistic wait, I suppose, is currently in NHS Grampian, which sits at about 15 to 18 months. In the Central Belt at the moment, clinics are somewhere between 3 to 4 years waiting time for people, as we currently see it with current provision.
Mm. So they're quite significant waiting times, as we've heard before. How does that figure of 4,000 compare with previous years, if you like, or maybe not just 1 year over time, though? Has that been a fairly static figure, or has it been increasing?
Yeah, I'm struggling to see the small print on my sheet here. I'm thinking that 2 years ago, if I'm reading this correctly, it certainly looks from the size of the graphic, it's about doubled as far as the number of people waiting since the same period 2 years ago.
Okay, thanks for that. And then when someone's receiving support from the gender identity clinic, how long, on average, does a person tend to receive support from yourselves? And I mean, I know there's probably varying degrees like everything else, but is there a sort of average length of time you would tend to support somebody for?
Yes, I guess so. Because everyone's journey is different. And so you have often quite an active initial phase, lots of discussion about what a treatment plan might look like, the things that people might want to access. Sometimes people are ready to move forward at that stage. Sometimes people move no further forward. Lots of different possible outcomes. And I guess if people are starting hormone treatment, that's probably about a 12-month period of quite intensive working with somebody, seeing them maybe 3 or 4 times over that next year, just to kind of support them with that treatment, check it's meeting their treatment goals, that safety is being well maintained for them. And then people might approach other interventions, such as maybe surgery in the future. They may come to that in a kind of, as they come to the end of that hormone kind of phase, if you like, or they may come back to it many years later. So we have people who are, if you like, are often actively starting some elements of treatment. They might get to a point where they continue with the situation where they are. They might come back to that in the future. So we expect that that there's always like an open door for people, should they want to do so in the future. That said, I mean, it's not the case that people need specialist care for lifelong. It's not. These interventions don't require that.
Thanks very much for that. One of the previous answers, you talked about the proportion of young people who are seeking appointments, and that was quite a high number. I wonder if you could expand on that. What numbers are we talking about, and if you've seen an increase in the number of young people seeking appointments.
There has. The increase over the last couple of years has been quite difficult to interpret because the effect of the pandemic, which initially certainly greatly reduced numbers being referred to services, I suspect, probably many services. And certainly over the last 6 months or so, I think in all aspects of service, including young people's service, that has increased quite sharply. It wasn't increasing that sharply prior to the pandemic, so I do wonder whether it might just correct itself. As people who may be now coming forward, that starts to level slightly. Certainly, I think the data from the GID service in London from several years ago suggested that things might be starting to, if you like, the increase is just starting to plateau slightly. So numbers, yes, are still increasing. I think our planning has been for year-on-year increases for about 20% in numbers. That's been our working position.
Okay, the interim cash review, which has been referenced in a number of the previous panel and panels before, has reported an increase in the number of young people seeking appointments at gender identity clinics. I accept that's primarily south of the border, but are you saying that it's possible that certainly for Scotland anyway, that is perhaps a outcome of the COVID pandemic, then, based on your previous answer?
I think there's been disturbance with the pandemic in the ebb and flow of people being referred, and I do wonder whether the very sharp increase in the last few months is a kind of almost a catching up of maybe people who didn't seek to get. We certainly hear in clinic people are still talking about not wanting to access their GP, being quite careful about how they are choosing to access healthcare, so there may still be, I guess, an element of people still coming forward who might otherwise have come forward a little bit sooner.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. And go to Pam Gossel, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, David. Thank you for your opening statement. The Royal College of General Practitioners Scotland submitted written evidence whereby they stated that current IT systems do not accommodate for transgender and non-binary patients, stating that the trans male cannot be referred for a cervical smear or to a gynaecology clinic if they are recorded as a male in the database despite having female reproductive organs. With an anticipated inflation in the number of GRC applications, do you have any concerns about decoupling of the legal and medical aspect of the gender reassignment?
So, thank you for the question. I think it's been the case since 2015 that people who are identifying in the main CHI index, which is the community hospital index system, which is where most, be the starting point for most patient records, wherever they ultimately end up being kept, changes. So that has a gender designator, which is currently male or female, that there's no other option in there at the moment. People changing that from 2015 would stay in a system for cervical smears. So people prior to that, there may be a workaround that needs to happen. I'm uncertain about the situation regarding gynaecology, and I would be happy to look into that and come back to you with a written answer, because I would certainly expect that somebody with a male CHI number, trans man, would be eligible to be referred to gynaecology.
On that, David, you've said that more work has to be done. Do you think it's in line with, obviously, the bill coming forward now?
Sorry, could you rephrase that
just
question?
Just basically, more work has to be done. If it's not been identified with the bill coming forward now, obviously, I have mentioned that there could be more people coming forward. So
basically around the readiness of our systems and databases, making sure that we are ready.
So thank you. So I think very specifically regarding whether people can be referred into gynaecology, I think that's a very quick thing for me to check. And I work in a service where we have a gynaecology aspect. It's never been brought to my attention that that's a problem. So I would want to just understand it a little bit better because it's not something that's been brought to my attention before. Regarding the situation regarding CHI and other hospitals, I guess our hospital record is contained often distributed across many different computer systems. That's a big piece of work that will take a long time, I think, to harmonise. Already it's not dependent upon somebody having a gender recognition certificate. So people are already getting to a point in their transition and they'll make that decision to change their CHI number with their general practice at the time that they feel is right. I don't think it's going to make a significant difference.
Thank you, David. I've got a second question. That's okay, convener. The CAS review into the gender identity services is ongoing, as you know, in England and Wales, and its interim report cited there has not been routine and consistent data collection, which means there is not possible to accurately track the outcomes and pathways that children and young people take through the service. Given that it's that state of duty to protect, it's the state's duty to protect, safeguard children's wellbeing, do you think the similar inquiry should be conducted in Scotland, followed by more detailed data collection to ensure there are no unintended consequences of the law?
So I was grateful to be able to see transcripts of some of the earlier evidence sessions to understand some of the comments that have been made about data. I mean, it's a big area, and there is certainly data collected in Scotland, and I wouldn't accept the suggestion that there's no data collected in Scotland, that there is. I think some of the, particularly when it comes to young people, numbers in Scotland of young people who move forward to treatment are extremely small. And I think this possibly causes a problem sometimes when requests are made for data, that the numbers will be such that it's probably impossible to actually give the number because of how small that number would be. And to give you an example, I think in the average number of young people moving on to puberty blockers in the last certainly 7 or 8 years has been about 7 a year. So in some years that will be at such a level that none of that data could be reported, let alone by a particular, by sex or gender or by health board or any sort of lower level. So I do wonder sometimes whether some of the requests for data have just been frustrated by it is actually quite a limited data set.
Do you think that that basically the numbers will increase with the GRC coming in?
I don't see that the GRC is going to make. I think the GRC regarding clinical practice, it's a really good question, and I think it's clearly important. If somebody has a GRC, that's a substantial act that they've taken, and it's relevant to their discussions they will have with their clinicians in the gender identity clinic. However, it's one of a multitude of different aspects that we will be looking at and thinking about. And I can't think of a situation, and I've given a lot of thought where that would even really probably swing something, let alone kind of passport something, if I can describe it that way. So yes, it's absolutely relevant for that person. It will be important for them, but I don't think it's going to have a significant... It's not going to change the direction of their clinical care.
Thank you, David.
Thanks very much. And Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning or good afternoon almost. David, thank you for the evidence that you've given us in advance, the work that you've done in this area as well, and also the questions you've answered this morning. I want to ask a little bit more about the service and the interaction with the service and the gender recognition certificate, just to kind of get under it a wee bit. Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board submitted information to the committee, and one of the things that they said is that it's important to clarify and highlight the separation between a successful application of a GRC and robust standards of gender identity treatment. Can you set out what you think that separation is for clarity so that we could have it on the record and whether and where they interact? And I note that you did touch on that a moment ago in your answer to my colleague Pam. Could you also set out where, if at all, in the gender reassignment protocol, a gender recognition certificate comes into play or is relevant?
Could you just repeat part of that first question for me, please? It's the part about the interaction between the gender recognition certificate and how you phrase the second part, please.
Yeah, Sorry, I'll try and remind myself, and maybe the record will correct me, but I think what I asked was about the information we got from Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board saying that it was important to clarify and highlight the separation between a successful application of a GRC and robust standards of gender identity treatment. A lot of evidence we've had in committee has kind of spoken about both aspects, I guess, of a trans person's life. So it's just to get your view on the separation of the certificate and the gender identity treatment that goes on in the NHS.
Thank you, I appreciate that. So we see, it's a very well-made point that the robust care that we offer to people as part of their gender identity healthcare is not affected by their course, their decision to apply or having applied and received a gender recognition certificate. It is like anything that people do administratively. It's important. It's a significant factor of their transition. It'd be relevant to those discussions. But, for example, if we're thinking about criteria for maybe somebody considering hormone treatment, all of that discussion is going to be about their needs, their aspirations, and their personal goals, and thinking about whether technically what is being proposed is feasible for them, and whether it's likely to have the outcome they're expecting. So I would see those as being very separated, and certainly people will, at the moment, will usually not be able to obtain a GRC until that formal diagnosis has happened. So we're going to see clearly a shift in that people will probably come to clinic with a GRC. One of the things that I think has always been important is I think it was touched on in one of the earlier evidence sessions about Section 22 of the Gender Recognition, current Gender Recognition Act, and that importance in privacy regarding gender identity. And I have always taken a position within the network and my colleagues that we treat everybody as they have a GRC, because that affords people the right amount of privacy. So that, for me, that means in practice, if I'm talking to somebody about writing a letter about them or talking to somebody else about them, I'm talking about getting their consent for that. So people are fully aware of what's happening, and they can be fully participating in those discussions. If they wish things to be done in a different way, they can say so. So I see them as, there are some intersections certainly, but I see them as being very separated, and will continue to be. I may be corrected, but I can't recall in the current gender reassignment protocol a specific meaningful discussion about gender recognition certificates. And in the current gender reassignment protocol review, it has not been a discussion that has been, it's not been a particularly, it will be touched upon in some of the workings, but it's not been a key discussion that we've had.
Thank you, that's really helpful. I just want to pick up on a point that we've heard in evidence in previous sessions. On that, we heard specifically that in Denmark there was a move from self-ID to access the gender recognition certificate to self-ID for medicalised processes such as gender identity treatment. Is this something that you could imagine happening here, or is this something that's being considered?
So the current review, there's been a lot of discussion, so the review is still ongoing, but certainly there's been a lot of discussion about what is the access point for treatments within, for people seeking trans healthcare, and also what is the access point if they're coming back to it, rather than at the first stage. So the review is moving forward in principles of realistic medicine, so we're thinking about shared collaborative decision making. So absolutely people need to be fully informed and able to consent to their treatment, but it's a much bigger process than that. It's about working really carefully with the person to help them to access the treatment that's right for them. So I don't see that as something that we're headed toward in Scotland, and certainly in the discussions that have included a wide range of stakeholders, there's been support for a more accessible sort of way forward, but based on realistic medicine principles.
Thank you. That is also very helpful. And then my final question is, can you set out, I guess this is probably going over ground that you already have, but just to be absolutely clear, can you set out what impact you believe that getting a gender recognition certificate would have on a person's ability to receive medical treatment?
I can't see it making a significant difference. So as I say, it's not irrelevant because it's absolutely important part of that person's journey, but it's not going to make a significant difference to their ability to receive treatment. I think what it will do, particularly where people, I can't, I've, people are so considered in how they approach transition. People will think so carefully about coming out and will often have internally thought about this thing, these things for many years. They will tell people slowly and carefully. They will decide at what point they're going to change their name, maybe have their pronouns changed, at what point they're going to do things formally. These are not things that people rush into. I think the impact of being able to have that autonomy as to when can I actually make that change at the time, I think it's right. I think it's huge for people, and I think it will have a really, really good positive impact.
Thank you. I have no other questions. Thanks.
Thanks very much. And now Emma Ruddick, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. Well, afternoon now. How much do you think a lack of awareness of the different experiences of trans people going to gender identity clinics and the different choices that they can legitimately make about what their journey looks like impacts on public views on what the process for a GRC should be?
Gosh, I don't know that I really have enough awareness of the public's understanding to answer that. But I suppose I can say, certainly even within health, there is often not a great understanding of actually what's happening. And certainly if we think about some of the questions that were asked and people just maybe just general requests for information, yes, there is a misunderstanding. I think there is not always an understanding. This is a very deliberative, considered process. So this isn't something that people are rushing into. And whilst I think it's important to say, sometimes I think people are saying, I'm really frustrated with the amount of time I've had to wait. I just want to get things moving along. But actually, when they arrive, that stops, and people are wanting to be really careful about, what does this mean for me? What do I want to do? And I think, yes, I think sometimes it would be nice to actually be more open about actually what happens here. This is about a really it's a mix of lots of different types of things that go on, but they are very person centred. They are very needs led, and there's certainly no prescriptive process throughout.
It's interesting you use the word prescriptive, because I think in the previous session we were talking about, you know, is there a standard of proof which, you know, gender dysphoria or something in its place that all trans people could meet to prove that they are trans before getting a GRC. In your view, is there anything that could fit that could apply to everyone who is trans in order for them to get a GRC?
I think I can't, and I've never been able to think of a really common analogous situation to kind of experience of gender incongruence that people experience. Very, very rarely people have quite significant other comorbidities which interfere with their sense of who they are, or something might be quite uncertain. So people might be uncertain, and that's certainly not uncommon. And therefore, thinking about how do I get to understand this better, how I get a better understanding of my experience, and that there are other people who have gone past that point, and actually their sense of that their assigned sex at birth and experienced gender is clearly mismatched. And I certainly can't think really of an analogous situation that people would really mistake for that. And certainly, whilst people do talk about that process of how do I get to where I am, I realised something wasn't maybe quite right, or something was different, and people would talk very eloquently as to how they have tried to maybe test different things. So maybe the first thing I notice is that, I've got some particular feelings about this part of my body, or something it's psychologically is happening for me. But actually they work these things through to a point where they're saying, I'm certain this is what it is. It's a very considered thing.
Okay, thank you for that. Moving on specifically to services, I'm very aware as a Highlands and Islands representative that currently all the clinics are based in cities. Do you deal with many people who are located in rural and island locations, and are there barriers, whether, you know, real or perceived, that people are coming up against when accessing your services?
I think one of the key changes since the start of the pandemic was this very quick move where it hadn't happened already, and I think in Highlands Islands they were probably ahead of the game, actually, of thinking about how virtual healthcare, telehealth, is actually delivered and how it's delivered well. And certainly that is now common in gender identity clinics. We are doing a lot of video working, a lot of thinking about actually what are other ways of doing this, and just thinking beyond that kind of structure sense of, oh, you have to have an appointment for this, that, or something else. There's other ways to kind of gain information or to kind of keep in contact with somebody throughout their healthcare. So certainly, yes, it's definitely changing. And I think that's a huge benefit for people, certainly more rural areas, but actually also people who are just busy. And it's that interruption to the day, and it kind of normalises things a little bit better for them.
Absolutely. Thank you. And that's all my questions, Convener.
Thanks very much. And Rachel Hamilton, please.
Well, I've got a succession of quick-fire questions, if I may. How many people using your services seek to obtain a GRC currently? Do you keep that data?
I don't have that data to hand, and I don't know that we keep it.
Okay. So if somebody came to seek medical treatment to obtain a GRC, you keep that data, do you? But if they seek medical treatment but don't obtain a GRC, you don't, or neither?
To get a GRC at the moment, you require two reports. One will come from your GP. And the other will come usually from a gender specialist, which is the psychiatrist report that we're talking about. So there's two medical reports required. The GP one is usually straightforward, although there may be a cost charged by some practices to obtain it. The psychiatrist one is often going to be for those people who've had surgery or have had a psychiatry appointment during their episode of care. And they would use the letter from that appointment as part of their GRC application. So for that reason, I may not know that somebody has applied for a GRC. They will have evidence they could use, but whether they wouldn't have necessarily approached us for that purpose. So people could make a GRC application and already have that evidence. So we wouldn't be able to record it, if that makes sense.
Okay. So if fewer trans people seek medical treatment to obtain a GRC by self-declaration, how do you know for the future what your service provision should be?
Very few people are, I apologize if I have misunderstood your first question, but very few people are accessing a gender identity clinic solely for the purpose of getting a gender recognition certificate. Sorry if I've misunderstood you. Very rare. I can only think of a handful of occasions.
That's helpful. Do you have a minimum age for service provision within your clinics?
The clinics do. So the adult clinics are 17 or 18, depending which clinic. And the young people's service, I don't know that there is a formal minimum age in the young people's service.
Has there been any analysis of the service provision need, bearing in mind that there is a long waiting list? If, for example, 16-year-olds required that your services, how do you know what the future holds for waiting lists? Because the whole objective of reform is to ensure that trans people are able to access services or, you know, get a more dignified experience.
Absolutely. So I think the reason why we got to where we are is a combination of services not always having the most secure funding and also a considerable increase in demand for them. I think there's both of those are factors in how we've arrived at the situation where we are today. So the Scottish Government Strategic Action Framework and funding that was announced last year, that there are plans, my understanding is all of the clinics are now well in the process of putting together cases that will be applications for funding for this year and then thinking about what the needs might be for future years. There is also an interest in thinking about whether there might be new services that might be possible in Scotland, whether that's from a health board that currently doesn't have a gender identity clinic, whether there might be, for example, a primary care-based service that might want to apply and to be developed and funded, certainly similar to some of the pilots that are now happening very successfully down in England. So I think there is now work underway, and certainly as part of that has been all of the service, all of the modelling, understanding there the resources required, obviously, and the extent of their waiting times.
You don't need to answer this question, but do you believe that
the service provision should have been put in place before the reform?
I'm not sure that I would quite know how to answer that question. I don't think that's works quite.
I know it's slightly unfair because obviously it's a very wide question and quite subjective. But just moving on to another tricky and challenging area is that some witnesses who are opposed to this bill have raised concerns that there could be medical oversight in the GRC process itself, and that a chance that other issues could be overlooked, such as mental health. I mean, we had a submission here from the RCGP who talked about vulnerabilities of young people, heightened risk of self-harm and suicide. Do you have any concerns about those particular challenges?
Absolutely, I have concerns about those things. And as part of the proposals to reform services, it's not simply to make more clinic appointments and to enable a pathway forward people on the waiting list. It's for people on the whilst they're waiting, also people who will never join the waiting list. So community support for people who may be looking for all kinds of intervention that's available to them too. Because you're absolutely right, if numbers of people on the waiting list are increasing or referrals are increasing, that need is increasing too.
And lastly, do you think that fewer trans people, and this is sort of based as a follow-up to that question, might seek medical treatment if they're able to obtain a GRC by self-declaration? And could that have unintended consequences, referencing the last question that we just talked about?
I think really based on the very few numbers who currently seek GIC referral just for the purpose of getting gender reconciliation, I think it's undoubtedly true, but I think the numbers will be very small.
So can I just ask, how would one go about getting a GRC and getting the paperwork without seeking the services of the GIC? What are the normal routes to that?
So the only way currently, I think, that you would be able to achieve that is by commissioning an independent report. So you would effectively go to a private provider who would be able to give you a report that would be suitable for the gender recognition panel.
So the National Health Service in Scotland is not the real route to getting that certification then?
It absolutely is a route for people if they wish to follow it. Well, I suppose my belief, and based on some examples that I know of, is that I know that's what people have done. So they have seen it as an easier option if they've been able to do that.
Is there any way I can get those figures if data isn't collected?
If I understand you correctly, that would be the number of people getting GRCs through private providers. It's possible the gender recognition panel themselves might have data on who's providing the reports. That might be one way to do so, but as the NHS, we wouldn't have known about that, so we wouldn't have that data.
Thank you.
Thank you. I don't think we've got any more questions. Thanks very much, David. That's been really, really helpful. That concludes the public part of our meeting, so we'll now move into private for the final items on our agenda. Thank you all very much.